At the K2 Mountains, 8,600 meter peak, oxygen is only 30% as dense as normal. Avalanches, rockfall, varying temperatures going as low as negative 50 Celsius, tough inclines that sap up energy and slow down attacks, as well as crevices covered by snow that act as pitfalls and traps for the overzealous. And of course, the psychological effects of the altitude in the brain. All of these factors need to be accounted for and fought against when climbing mountains in winter. But the K2 isn't a normal mountain. It's the second highest peak on Earth, taking at least 70 to 80 total hours to climb. And that's if the weather even allows you to. There's something even more amazing about this mountain, though. It's the K2's eastern face. In history, several teams have attempted to conquer this route. No one has succeeded. It remains an unfulfilled dream. At a Japanese high school down on land, we meet Mori Buntaro, a recent transfer student being pushed into the spotlight on his first day of class. After his introduction and motionlessly sitting in his chair, Mori is distant. He's unwilling to interact with his educational or social life at school. Yet his daydreaming nothingness only leads him to be gawked at and pestered by his peers, as they're captivated by his sudden and mysterious appearance. In his seeking to be alone from his school's intrigued populace, Mori decides to skip class and rest on the school's roof, though his introverted peace quickly crumbles when a new fellow classmate, Miyamoto, follows him up there, climbing up the building. We're shown how Mori plans to isolate himself through this encounter with Miyamoto, seeking to spend the whole day on the roof, hidden. And we're also introduced to the brash nature of Miyamoto's conflict-creating outgoingness, seeing a challenge for Mori. Mori argues with Miyamoto, wanting to be left unbothered, yet the intruder stands his ground, issuing a simple challenge for Mori if he seeks to be alone. Mori needs to climb up to the roof the way Miyamoto did. Surprisingly, and in his first act of agency, Mori quickly accepts the challenge, and without even a rope attached to himself, he free-climbedly grapples up the wall with proficient haste, leaving an awestruck Miyamoto and other onlookers in a much more expressive way than Mori's first introduction to class. Miyamoto didn't expect Mori to even try climbing, as he was much more egotistically sure about himself being the only climber. But he also becomes genuinely concerned for Mori's safety as he anxiously helps guide Mori through the climbing process when he gets stuck towards the top wall. It's engaging to see how quickly Mori risks his life just to be left unbothered by his classmate, but also how during this climb, Mori discovers that he actually enjoys climbing as he feels energized and alive in it. Just as Mori conquers his first trial, he meets his teacher, Onishi, who, after disciplining him for his recklessness, notices how Mori seems changed by this short climb. The climb wasn't just done to escape others, but it ultimately developed something inside of Mori, a progressive interest in his life, which his teacher empathetically notices. Onishi points to something, a real goal for Mori to seek, a mountain overlooking the school. Something much grander than just a building's wall, but something that Onishi instructs Mori he can't just climb as haphazardly and unfocused as this first ascent. It's a great moment between Onishi and Mori, as Onishi takes a real authoritative care as Mori's teacher when he notices him interested in climbing. He doesn't just punish him or see him as an outcast like the other school's leaders. And now, after first feeling the rush of climbing, Mori won't climb simply to get away from people. He actually enjoys climbing as it allows him to have focus while being by himself. It empowers him. It's great to see Mori develop some purpose instead of just daydreaming and disfocusing on school, trying to run away from pain. He now has a focus on the mountain, adding a direction to the story and Mori's growing character. Before Mori can climb this mountain, however, he's forced to join the newly founded climbing club at the high school, which Onishi works hard to get off the ground, as he too is a veteran in the activity of climbing. Mori now has to interact with Miyamoto, a fellow member, and the rest of the club. Through practice, rock wall climbing, and club trips, we see Mori still remain distant from his peers, completely ignoring them and paying complete attention to climbing. He develops a philosophy and style of solo free climbing, where he's not anchored by ropes and protective gear, and also not bothered by fellow climbers. It's thrilling to see Mori continue on a path of such resistance by his classmates and teacher, Onishi, who critiques his closed-off nature. Onishi really sees climbing as a cooperative sport, not just a solo activity, which we learn through the teacher's past experiences climbing in groups. Through the narrative, we begin to learn why Mori transferred schools, why he's so distant and anxious to be around people. We come to understand a basis for this obstacle present in Mori's life, as well as his journey in climbing. He enjoys solo climbing because it allows him to travel alone, to progress on his own terms. Climbing with a team and having to worry about accidentally endangering someone, something he feels responsible for greatly because of an incident that made him transfer schools in the beginning. But alone, he is completely in control of himself and the climb. And yet, in this present, the only way for him to climb is by participating in his school's club, being around Miyamoto and others. Climbing in groups isn't just social interaction, it's depending on others, and being depended on by others. When Mori can't trust those around him, when he feels so disconnected and far from understanding them, and when he can't even trust himself, as he feels like he's hurt people in his past due to weakness, this shining light that is climbing for Mori starts to become tangled in the very thing he first climbed to escape. But it's an interesting position, as this club really is the only way for Mori to climb. So seeing him actively participate in it still, in his own distant and lone-seeking way, bringing on judgment from his peers, is an intriguing conflict. After participating in a rock wall contest, and doing fairly well for the most of it only to disqualify himself in the final moments, where he attempted to free climb to the end, Mori is reprimanded by his teacher over his disregard for the safety of climbing rituals. Even if it's just a free climb, he has to see it as a legitimate climb, as this is a tool for learning how to climb mountains, where you can't just disregard your tools and ropes in a foolish rush to the top. Mori is seen as careless when it comes to safety, because he believes so much in his style of climbing, seen in how he so quickly and decisively made this decision to remove his safety rope. It's not made in a belief in himself, but that Mori, loosening his rope and letting go of his desperate hold on the rock wall, allowed him to find new strength in himself, easily regaining a new, stronger hold on the rock. Something many in the audience don't see. It's not that Mori is just technically skilled in climbing. His relationship with the rock is also very different from the other contestants. He doesn't see everyone around him watching him climb in this competition. He sees just the rock and himself. Transformed through his surroundings, he trusts the character of the rock. He's less afraid than the people around him. He didn't decide to let go of his rope because he wasn't thinking of it as a real climb. He was actually so immersed in a real mountain climb that he saw the rope's removal allowed for a temporary boost in energy needed to finish. He's a real climber. It's great to see him be able to completely change his outlook into only including him and this pictured mountain. It's something that protects him from his fear of others, which is strange and anxious. To Mori, a mountain is comforting, and this relationship reoccurs through the story often, which creates a character for the mountains themselves. Seeing how much he trusts these structures not only helps demonstrate the harsh relationship he has with others in a contrast, but also shows how much he connects to climbing the mountains without being afraid of them like people. It's greatly shown visually, especially with how almost mindlessly Mori climbs up, with no hesitation. It's great to see Mori not fight his surroundings, not attempt to hide himself from his classmates or escape people's view, but to live in and embrace the moment of climbing, of seeing the top of the climb, even if it's just a rock wall. But soon after this first step in his life as a climber, Mori faces the real dangers and conflicts that come with climbing real mountains. As the time passes in the narrative, through well-planned time skips, Mori, now out of high school and working a part-time job, starts to seek out winter climbs, the most dangerous season for mountaineering, as the snow and ice really exacerbates the changing temperatures and makes rain even harsher and unwelcoming. But for Mori, it's more beautiful, it's more peaceful, as there's not many climbers that surround him in this time of year. The beauty found, however, is founded on the deaths of so many climbers, which the narrative presents as we see how quickly a climber's estimation is clouded by their zealousness for climbing, leading in the many cases of death. Mori has a patience, which follows his personality in life, but those around him, which he's still forced to climb with, aren't as understanding of the danger. They let themselves be blinded by their past victories, a blindness that often kills them. Many more variables have to be accounted for. Snowfall and avalanches, the energy that's sapped more quickly in steep snow. It's all much more challenging. Yet Mori embraces these factors, willingly going on these winter climbs. Seeing Mori practice throughout the story, such as certain lunges, weight training to simulate equipment while climbing, and breath training, is so greatly peppered throughout the story. Mori never stagnates in his development, he's always seeking to improve, which is especially needed in his solo climbing style, where he can only depend on himself. It's interesting to see how he lets the mountains lead his life, even in the way he's chosen his occupation to allow him for more time studying climbs. It's impactful because we see it's a sacrifice to his social and economic life. He surrenders a lot of the normalcy that he finds no joy in for the climbing lifestyle, his saving grace from suffering in life. But it's also interesting to see how, as Mori develops as a character and climber, he doesn't seek to improve his social skills, to learn to express himself to others and take charge in his life, which ends up leading him to be easily manipulated and abused, as he's docile and always willing to take the easiest way out of conflicts or even talking to someone. But Mori purposefully seeks the ever-growing challenges of more complex mountains, which start to require him to be working in a team, where we often see his social weaknesses become a vulnerability in climbing. Specifically, it's leadership that he has trouble submitting to, as it involves putting trust in someone rather than just your own climbing experience, which up till now, he's depended on completely. It's scary for Mori to have to trust someone, to put faith in their decision-making, as he's been climbing solo for so many years now, and it's also scary to have people depending on himself when his actions matter the most for their survival. Another unique element of climbing is that it's one of the rare times that Mori somewhat connects to or tries to understand others, whether it's past climbers that gave their lives climbing certain mountains, the people he's sometimes forced to work with, or just when he feels a connection to someone's previous journey. Mountains are one of the only times that he can converse with others, even if it's purely in Mori's head, which adds to the use of psychological issues in this story. Many symbolisms are experienced through hallucinations, for instance, which add not only a symbolic and interesting visual expression of a theme, or just showing the immense stress being experienced during climb, but it also adds a real connection and feeling as we understand more about Mori while climbing. Whether it's showing how close Mori is to dying at points, or how victorious and elevating finally achieving the summit is, we see it all through these recurring, visually stunning scenes, which add to our connection to Mori's dream. What still drives Mori, even now after he's left the high school and the climbing club, is his dream of climbing higher and higher peaks. But one dream has consumed him like the first school mountain, that being to climb the K2's eastern face, Virgin Land, the ultimate winter climb. Dreams are important in the narrative of Climber, as we see it recur in several different characters we meet. There are those who live for their dreams, constantly chasing it, those that die for them before they can fully reach their apex, and those who let their dreams die after giving up on them. We see the young and old team members Mori has to climb with, practicing for K2, having this thirst for the dream, which they all share. And it was shown with how those with dreams can so quickly tear at each other with competitiveness, even if they all share the same goal. There's almost an inherent selfishness in this dream of climbing the K2. These climbers have forsaken those on ground, their social lives and the society it lives in, and all their relationships, just so they can climb, and it leads them to be somewhat chaotic and conflict starting, which Mori is trapped in the middle of, because he too wants to climb this mountain. It's like Mori is back in high school with the club, and even in the many ways Mori has grown through time, he still chooses to be alone, but he's not become content with his state, because he still can't defend himself against others' questioning, such as those at his work or the mountaineers he climbs with, usually giving in to their ideas rather than standing up for himself. He's still uncomfortable and unable to be around people, as their presence unnerves him. He can't understand them, and so he can't connect with them through trust. He isn't able to face his own mountain of being human on ground, so he decides to throw himself into climbing the mountains above to run away from them. Now though, with his climbing team, he's forced to face communicating with others if he truly wants to climb the ultimate K2 mountain. And it's a great plot device that allows us to explore these two conflicts in Mori's life, his place in society and his place on the mountains. Up till now, Mori's been able to climb freely by himself, but now that his ultimate goal as a climber has begun, we see that this challenge also involves growing as a person. For Mori to be the ultimate climber, he needs to become comfortable around people, around their unknown secret thoughts and wishes as well as their dreams, and he is able to work on this when he's involved with his team preparing to climb K2. I just love this thread, because just when we see the final goal of Mori, the final direction of being a climber, we're faced with the same obstacle from the beginning, his life, in society, and amongst people. Being alone isn't bad, but if you only choose to be alone as a way to escape and run from your fear of others, you only get weaker. Something Mori shows when even though he's so talented as a climber, he can't really work with others without becoming vulnerable. It's a real well-written conflict, seeing Mori actually have to face the flaw he's run from for so long if he wants to fulfill his dream. It adds a depth to the K2 climb as well, because he can't just climb to escape people. He now has to climb purely for climbing itself. His passion can't be fulfilled in his current state of anxiety. Dreams are just explored so well in this story, but I think in Mori's case, it's the most interesting. Mori has been living for his dream since the beginning of the story, but now that the journey has evolved in requiring him to work on living with others and trusting others, he has to actually live with this dream, involving another evolution of Mori's character, which we see later in the story. I don't really want to spoil much of the climber's plot because it's really beautiful, but one thing I'll talk about is just how much Mori grows in the story. He's a very captivating character because of all of these intense conflicts he faces with just being alone, trying to live with so much anxiety and trauma that he feels responsible for. But when he starts to confront the problems, like he confronts the mountains he climbs with courage and just the bravery of going through an abyss, it's great. We feel good when he's rewarded for his bravery because we see just how hard it is for him to even attempt to open up with people. Ultimately, I feel like the story shows a potential new way to live with one's dream. You don't just ignore everything that causes pain and everything you're vulnerable in just to follow your dream 100%, because when you have to face these conflicts in the journey of realizing your dream, you'll fail. In some cases, we see in Climber, failing to your weaknesses cause death. And you shouldn't just give up on your dream and let you live a life full of regret simply because you chose a safe option. You should have the faith in yourself to be able to overcome these conflicts, as we see how much Mori has resolve when it comes to climbing and the numerous quick decisions that come with his bravery. He can definitely be strong enough to open up and live with others in trust. Life shouldn't be lived simply chasing a dream, because what does it really mean to achieve the peak of a mountain if you have no one and nothing to return to? What is a life or victory with no one to share it with? You should joyfully live in the moments that you're advancing your dream, and the moments of rest that allows you to continue it. I love seeing all these different ideas of the dream of Mori coalesce and manifest through the psychologically thralling narrative of the climber. Now, I'm going to be doing a quick review of the art and visual side of the climber. It's great. I think it's great just being apparent even in the beginning volumes. One thing I think is immediately apparent is just how skilled Sakamoto is at drawing faces and expressions, especially seen in the detailed, luscious, and textured lips on characters that really do show a wide range of emotions, like confidence and dumbfoundedness. It's captivating to see our characters, you know, their faces turn from self-assuredness to complete anguish as mountains fall apart around them. And the rock falls themselves are drawn with a powerful, lifelike movement, you know? The art all goes to show how tense and stressful climbing is, with each shifting movement of our climbers that use tools to break into the ice in front of them. It's great to see the details of their ascent, and especially with the nice flow and rhythm that's thanks to the paneling of scenes. And also, you know, the picturesque scenes of victory, you know, on top of mountains, or just down on land with just these beautiful interactions with people, especially when Mori is such, you know, just a very anxious person. It's just very beautiful. All the emotions are just really well made in the story. Finally, for my outro and conclusion, I want to talk about some negatives. Okay, the first two volumes, which were not written by Shin-ichi Sakamoto, are kind of generic. The storytelling is just not that great. The direction is a little bit like, it's just kind of boring. It's very much carried by the uniquely expressive art that Sakamoto still does. And, you know, after the first two volumes, he begins writing it, and it becomes very direct and very amazing. Sometimes the fast pacing takes away from emotional impact in the story. We oftentimes cut away from the aftermath of arcs at the end, which I feel like it would be a little bit nice to revel in some of the aftermaths of the arcs. And Mori's journey is just amazing. There's a whole third of the story I don't want to talk about because it's just very great and you need to read this. The ending as well is amazing. So aside from a few cons that I've mentioned, I'm going to give this a final review, final verdict of 9.5 out of 10. And that's it. If you like this video, please give it a like, subscribe, comment, hit the bell notification. I don't know. Just do something cool today, you know? And maybe that is subscribing to me. Hope you enjoy the video. Bye.